Hi, and welcome to CMPUT301, Refactoring Principles. We're going to talk more about refactoring. All right. So, basically, what we're going to talk about is a basic catalog of refactoring. And the whole point is, we've got these named refactorings, we can apply them, and they don't change that word behavior. We can reduce the risk of change by basically doing it one step at a time and testing each step and iterating. By doing small refactorings, our system should always be working because we do not change outward behavior. After a successful refactoring, nothing should have changed other than the quality of the system. So, what we want to do is we want to basically in code design intent within class structure. We want to reorganize code. We want to look for sharing of logic, and we want to express conditional logic in clear ways. One limitation is sometimes this results in too much indirection, like you saw in the previous video, and there can be a big performance impact. Basically, also, if you have to change, you might have to change published interfaces, and significant design changes might occur, and they might not really be that possible. When should you not refactor? Basically, when you should rewrite. When something's so bad that there's no way to get around it, and the behavior's going to change, so you're rewriting it, you shouldn't refactor close to a deadline, because it could go bad, but at least you have version control. So, Ward Cunningham says, unfinished refactoring is like going into debt. That is fine as long as you can meet the interest payments, which are basically, in our cases, extra maintenance costs. If there's too much debt, you'll be overwhelmed. So there's different kinds of refactorings, just like different kinds of patterns. But one kind is creating methods. Basically, these are meant to reduce the size of methods and improve the readability of code and give chunks of code names. So extract method is to take code from an existing method and extract it. Inline method is to basically extract a small method and basically in C++ make it inline so you don't have to keep retyping the same thing. And then there's replace temp with query, and what replace temp with query does is basically we take temporary variables and we make a query method. The query method answers a certain question like what is the total cost of all the movies, or for all the attributes of this class, or all the children of the class, is there a size or something along those lines. Basically, take something that would be a little bit of computation and use a temporary variable to store and replace it with a method call such that you can reuse it at any time. Other kinds of refactorings include things like move methods. They're moving things around, moving things between objects. So these aren't just like making new methods. These are basically deciding that a responsibility of one class is better met by a by another class who's already cohesively responsible for those things. So oftentimes you'll move a field, a method. Sometimes you'll even take a class with too many responsibilities and you'll extract an entire class out of it to delegate that responsibility to. Like we did with the price objects, where we delegated the responsibility of new releases and their behavior to a new release price. Other kinds of refactoring are about basically organizing data. Sometimes objects can be used instead of simple data items, like replace a postal code string with a postal code object, replacing data values with objects, replacing arrays with objects. Arrays are pretty low level in Java, so it's a bit of a problem. Another kind of refactoring is basically dealing with conditional expressions and logic, and they can be really difficult to understand. So one thing you can do is you can rely on the dot operator, polymorphism, to basically improve the logic. Another kind of refactoring is just to make, method calls simple. Complicated programming interfaces can be difficult to use if they got lots of names, or they have a lack of names, or they're inappropriately named, it causes problems. So renaming a method is basically the simplest refactoring. Eclipse and other IDEs like Android Studio and IntelliJ, they do these kinds of refactorings. Another kind of refactoring is to add a parameter. Basically, if you're using the code over and over again, you're duplicating code, maybe you should just move it to one spot and add a parameter to it. other kinds of refactoring deal with generalizations. This is about moving code around to the correct classes. And usually this is in reference to a hierarchy, whether by you've got a superclass and subclasses. So the pullup method is to pull up a method from a subclass to a superclass, whereas a pushdown method is to take a method that's inappropriate for the superclass to have and to push it down. There's also class extraction. So there's extract subclass, whereby a certain sub-functionality of a class is removed and put into a subclass. And sometimes there's extract superclass, where you have a collection of classes that do duplicate behavior or have duplicate code, and you want to move the code into one coherent place where they can all call upon it and act cohesively as kind of the same type. And that would be an extract superclass. All right, so now I'm sort of done with the refactoring. I went over them briefly, but the prior videos went through a big walkthrough. We basically have creation, moving, organization, simplifying, generalization. Okay. Now I'm just going to talk about general Java stuff you should consider. So Hagar, they talk about general techniques that are good Java practices, objects inequality, things like this. I'm going to go through some of it. These are just general hints that you can do. So understand that non-static methods can be overridden by default. And overriding methods can sometimes cause you a lot of pain because you can do it accidentally, or it means that people can get rid of the code that you worked really hard on. So one thing you can do is you can use call things final, and this prevents subclasses from overriding it. It's kind of rude because it means there's nothing they can do as a subclass to deal with it, and the only way they can override the behavior is through delegation. Hagar also recommends you choose carefully between arrays and vectors, and array lists. He doesn't recommend array lists. They weren't really around at the time. But basically, arrays are static. They're pretty, they have good performance. They're good for primitive types like integers, whereas vectors and array lists, they grow and they have certain speed limitations, and vectors themselves, they have synchronized access. So they're very thread safe, but they get slow because of that. If you call instance of in Java, basically it means you should really consider using polymorphism instead, like a dot operator. If you have to safely downcast, instance of should only be used when you really have to, so downcasting and things like that. Basically, instance of is a bad code smell. It says that you're not using the OO structure of the system to your advantage, and you're basically using type codes. For memory management, if you set an object reference to null, it indicates to the garbage collector that it's ready to be culled, and it helps you reduce memory usage. Basically, if you have too many references to the object, it's going to be hard to garbage collect. So setting it to null is like a little hint to the garbage collector that you're done. For Java classes and interfaces, you should define and implement immutable classes judiciously. And sometimes you want objects that do not change. So if you have an immutable class, it gives you a lot of benefits that you know that it won't change on you at all. So you can use it in threads and parallelism. Whereas a class is mutatable, you have to lock it in order to make sure it doesn't change on you. So one way to do immutable classes is you basically declare everything private so you don't let people mess with it. You set all the data in the constructor and you have getters. And you also define the class final such that people can inherit from it. The cool thing about immutables is that you can clone them easily. You can just make new ones from the constructor, so clone is easy. And you can also, one way you can deal with the referencing issue is that you can, if you reference a mutable object, you can clone it before returning it in a getter method. So you can return a clone. Yeah, so that's pretty handy. And then when you call a constructor on something, you can clone the objects themselves. So one way to stay completely immutable is to always copy your data, right? Instead of doing references, you just copy. And this immutability means that you can do cool stuff in threads and things like that. and you can share references across threads because it's going to be read-only. No one's got to worry about it changing. Another thing with Java classes and interfaces is you should basically use delegation or inheritance to define immutable classes from the mutable ones. So the point is you want to reference a mutable object through an immutable interface. So you could imagine something like you've got like your color class, right? And this color class has RGB, right? And you've got set color in there. So if what I could do is I could make a mutable color and it could have a color. And then it could have R, G, B. And this, it might be good to put it there. So you kind of get what I mean. Like this thing will have one color. And it'll basically just wrap it. And its get R will basically be something like that. So that's kind of what they mean. So if you delegate to the mutable object, then you can completely wrap it and you don't have to worry about things like that. And you can also avoid sharing the type if necessary. Another way to do it is you have like an immutable abstract class, and derived classes can be mutable and immutable if they want to be. So that was mostly what Hagar had to say. And then Block had a couple of things to say about Java. The common methods to all objects are basically equals, hash code to string, clone and comparable, or clone to string, hash code equals. And what you should do is when you're doing equals is you have to watch out because equals, if you override it, you should also override hash code such that it matches equals. If your hash codes are equals, equals should be equals too. And you should consider overriding to string. Also, people really like having clone. So if you can just clone the object, then it's safe and allows you to do these immutable tricks I was talking about. And comparable is also a good interface to implement. It allows your objects to be compared against each other as greater than, less than, things like that. For classes, you should really try to lock everything down, keep them private, stuff like that, unless you need to really give access. The idea is that inheritance has a tendency to kind of mess with you, so delegation and composition tend to be better. Furthermore, if you do use inheritance, design for it, document it, otherwise prohibit it with final. And in general, people prefer interfaces to abstract classes. And you should really consider that for every class you write that's going to have maybe another one of it, like another implementation of it, you should never refer to that class. You should avoid referring to that class directly unless it's in the factory or something like that. Instead, you should define an interface for that class and such that any related classes just have to implement that interface. And so if you're basically using interfaces to define types, then your concrete types will not invade the rest of your code. The rest of your code will be at the interface level rather than the concrete type level. And then that allows you to switch things up. For methods, like I think in your projects you really needed this. Check for parameter validity. You don't know what the other programmer did. Check for nulls. And make copies of things defensively when you need them. You should also consider the order of the method signatures. A lot of people don't really consider the design of it very carefully, but it does communicate certain things, and it can confuse people. Also, if you return zero length arrays for zero results, it's better than a null because you can still ask it its length. So if you have a method and it returns a list or a collection, if it returns a zero length one of those collections, it can at least answer that question that it has zero of them. Whereas if you just return a null, you can't call a null anything. So that's a bit of a problem. Furthermore, you should make sure that you use Javadoc on every exposed API element. Okay, so if you want more information, check Martin Fowler's great book on refactoring. Check out Brown et al.'s book on anti-patterns. There's Practical Java, Effective Java. For a discussion on if code clones and duplicate code is good or not, consider finding this paper, Cloning Considered Harmful, where they find plenty of good uses of code cloning. There's also a refactoring webpage. And that's about it. All right, thanks for your time.